Hello, everyone. Welcome to the first seminar of the year. For those of you who are new, welcome to UCI. We'll see you, I think, all of the quarter in the seminar. Those of you who are new, also a reminder to sign up at the door. I'll keep attendance for the course for that. And with that, I'm really excited to have Sam introduce our first speaker of the year.
All right, hi everyone. So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Hua Kan Dam from University of Wollongong. Hua is on his sabbatical trips, in other words, a paid vacation. Oh wait, this is being streamed. So he's gone to UBC and he was at UCLA and he's gonna spend 2 weeks here at Irvine, and then I think he's going back home. So he saved the best for last. The area of research is in AI and software engineering. He has worked in quality assurance, security, and generally developer productivity. He's won several Best Paper Awards, including an ACM SigSoft Distinguished Paper Award. He's been on the editorial board for several journals. He's the deputy editor-in-chief for Springer's Automated Software Engineering Journal. And he was the head of the school's research and postgraduate studies. And it's really my pleasure to welcome him to UCI. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, William, for a very nice introduction. It's my pleasure to be here at UCI, and it's also my pleasure to be the first one to talk in this seminar series for the year. So today I will talk about, because I'm going to be here for 2 weeks, right? So I was thinking now whether I'm going to talk very details in one specific topic, or should I talk broadly about my research areas? Because I've been here for a while, so I'm thinking about, let me talk about different topics that we work in. And then if you are interested in different areas of my work, I'm happy to talk to you throughout my visit in the next 2 weeks as well. Right? So the work that I'm doing is AI for software engineering, in the intersection of AI and software engineering. But before I talk about it, let me answer your question. Right? So where's Wollongong? Right? Where's Wollongong? So this is our cities. So we also have the mountain, we have the beach, we have everything. And we only just 1 hour from Sydney. Right? We only just 1 hour from Sydney. If you travel from Sydney, you will travel along that, you know, beautiful coastline here. And we have skydiving. We have beautiful beaches, which is exactly the same here, but it's in Australia. Right? So next time, if you come to Australia, if you come to Sydney, please do visit us. We are University of Wollongong. It's just 1 hour from Sydney. So I am the director of the Decision System Lab. So the lab was established in 1998. We have 4 academies. We have 1 postdoc at the moment. We have 8 PhD students and 2 master students. So our work is in the intersection of AI and software engineering. So a lot of our work that I'm presenting today is about AI for software engineering. We also do some projects on engineering's AI for autonomous IoT systems. So at the end of my talk today, I will give you a brief introduction to one of the projects that we did for the national park, which is found in these areas. We also do enterprise AI analytics. So some of our publication, you can see it show up in venues like service-oriented computing and business process management and so on. So that is in the areas of enterprise for AI analytics. But my focus of today's talk is about AI and software engineering. So before I give you the details of my work, I would like to take you back to about 10 years ago when we started looking into applying AI for software engineering, right? And around that time, we set up 3 visions, right? We set up 3 visions. So the first one is using language model for software engineers. So this is, we published this in 2016, right? This is well before LLM and so on and so forth, right? We envision that we can apply language models for software engineering, right? So that will in our paper at MSCs in 2016. Okay. And then another vision that we have about 10 years ago is the ideas of explainable AI for software engineers. Okay. And then the last one is using LLM, building LLM agents for software project management. Okay, so that is the three visions that we started about 9-10 years ago. And in my talk today, I will show you the work that we have implemented for the three visions, right? In different activities of software engineering, from software project management to security vulnerability prediction, right, to microservices and so on and so forth. Okay. So the first work that I would like to talk about today is AI for project management, or AI for software project management. And one of the problems that we try to solve at the time is delay prediction. So when you talk about software project, right, we used to hear a lot about software project, over the budget, delays, and so on and so forth. So we need to solve this problem, right? How to solve this problem? We need to predict delays, right? We need to predict delays, and by predicting the delays, we come up with ways that we can mitigate the delay risk. So as a project manager, you are under a lot of pressure and so on and so forth. And one of the questions that you would like to answer every day that you lead in your project is, right? Let's say that you have in a deadline. Right? A deadline is in November the 2nd, you need to deliver this milestone, right? You need to release version 2.1 on the 2nd of November. Right? To deliver that milestone, your team need to complete, 100 of tasks. Right? There's 100, in a large software project, there could be 100 of tasks, right? There could be 100 of these tasks, ongoing tasks. So as a project manager, as a team leader, what do you need? You need to have a dashboard, something like this, right? This is the future dashboard. A dashboard that can predict that, these are the tasks that are going to be major delays, right? The red one, right? These are the tasks that have a minor delays. These are the tasks that are going to be on track to finish on time. Right? But these are on future prediction, right? So this is the question that we want to solve. We want to solve that among these 100 of tasks is ongoing tasks, open tasks, which one have the high risk of delays. Okay, so this is the question that we try to solve. Okay, so we solve these problems by this is back in 2016, 2015, right? So we use, some of the classical machine learning classifiers. Okay, so what we did is that we look at the task, look at the software task, for example, the one that you can see on the picture there. So if you work in software project, right, that most of the tasks are recorded in an issue tracking system. So for example, like Jira, you familiar with Jira? Right, so when this is the task that, this is an example of a software task that are recorded in the Atlassian Jira issue tracking system. Right, this is a very popular project management that I use in the industries. Okay, so what we did is that we extract the attribute in the task, right, the people that the task assigns to, right, and then we use these and the features to build a classifiers, to build a machine learning classifiers. Right? And we found that the result is quite promising. As you can see, in terms of precision and recall, random forest, this is very classical machine learning, right, very basic machine learning models. It can make the prediction is as accurate as 80%. So we did, this is a study that we did using like over 40,000 tasks in 5 large software projects. Okay. And then when we look at the task, right, when we look at the task, we found that there are dependency in software engineering tasks. Right? There are some tasks that block another task. There are tasks that depend on another task. So there's a graph dependencies, right? So there's a dependency between tasks, okay? There's a dependency between issues, right? In software, in a typical software project. Okay, so that method, the intuition there is that if task A depend on task B, and if task B is going to be a delay, then task A is a first list, I'm so have a very high chance of delay as well. So there's a delay propagation between bus A, bus B, bus C, and so on. Okay, so that's why we think about using a graph, you know, a graph based machine learning models. Right? So we expanded our work earlier, and we using the graph dependencies, and we found that the graph based, right, the one on the right hand side here. So these are the graph based models. So it's performed better than just only use the traditional, you know, individual features in FAST. Okay, so we published that in 2015, and then recently in 2024, we expanded that work, right, by providing the explanation as well. So in our previous works, we predict that this FAST is delayed, right? Delay, major delay or minor delays. So it's just a classification, but it doesn't give the explanation. It doesn't give the software developer or the project manager why the model thinks this task is a delay. So in the 24 words that we just finished, so we'll be able to explain, right? Explain the reason that the model in this is going to be a delay task. Okay, so that is one problem that we solve for using AI for software project management. Okay. Another problem that we try to solve is effort estimation. Right. Traditionally, when we estimate the efforts for software, right, you're thinking about using like Kokomo, like function points, and so on and so forth, right? These are classical effort estimation. But today, right, people use agile, right, using agile project management, like Scrum, like Extreme Programming, and Kanban, and so on and so forth. So they don't talk about Kokomo anymore. They don't talk about function point anymore. Right? They talk about storyboard, right? So in the project, in the typical software project, we have user stories, right? User story is a description here, for example, is a description of the features or functionality that the team is going to develop for the application. And every user story, the team need to estimate the storyboard. So they have section like planning poker, right? Know if you do agile, you have planning poker, and in the planning poker section, every team member try to estimate the story point, which is the efforts of implementing a user story, right? So now we want to automate that, right? We want to build a machinery that can automatically estimate, right, the story point for every user stories, right? For every user story here, we want to build a model that can do this estimation. Okay, So about five years ago, we proposed this model, right? This is also using a language model as well, right? LSTM is one of the classical language models. Okay? So we build a end-to-end models, right? So as you can see, as the input there, we have a user story, right? So we tokenize the user stories into a user story's description and title into a number of tokens, right? And then we embed every token, right, into a vector. We fit into an LSTM model, right? And then the output of the LSTM model is also an embedded vector. And then we aggregate these vectors together, right? And then at the end, we got a vector that represents the user stories. And then we use that vector representation, input it into another neural network layers, right? And then this is where it's output the estimated story points. Okay. So the results, the evaluation result is over there. This is our approach, right? This is our approach. This is the errors compared to the ground truth. So the lower, the better, right? This is, we compare with some of the other baselines. We also implemented as a plugin to Jira as well. Right? So Jira, they have the, you know, user stories, and they have this Atlassian, you know, Atlassian marketplace. So we develop a plugin. Right. And that plugin, we integrate it into the Jira tracking system. And then you see that is an example of how the plugin is used. So it recommends the story points. It allows the users to accept or reject the recommendations. And at the same time, it also makes some other recommendations as well, as you can see on the screen there. Yeah. So we published this works as the IEEE transaction on software engineering in 2017. Okay, so that is another problem that we try to solve. So delay prediction, story point effort estimation. So now it's still in the context of AI for software project management, but this is particular for agile project management. Right? So the problem that we try to solve here is to make a prediction on the deliveries. So when you follow agile, right, when you follow Scrum, for examples, so you develop the software in term of iteration, right? One iteration followed by another iteration and so on and so forth. Right? So these iterations are called a sprint, right? One sprint, right? One sprint is typically about 4 weeks, okay? So 4 week sprint, okay? And the problem that we try to solve is that, you know, before the sprint, the software team will try to do one section called sprint planning. This is important, the sprint planning. So at the beginning of the sprint, they do sprint planning. So what are the main purpose of sprint planning? Sprint planning, they need to identify the stories, the user stories, the tasks that they will commit to do in the upcoming sprint. Right? So basically they have something like that checklist over there. So a list of user stories or a list of tasks, right? Or what we call a list of product backlog items that they need to complete for the upcoming sprints, right? And remember every items in that to-do list, right? They have a story point, right? Every single item there, they have a story point that represent the efforts or the complexities of that particular product backlog items, right? So let's say that the team select 10 items, right? These are the 10 user stories that they want to complete, right? For the upcoming sprints. And every of them have a story point, right? So if you aggregate them up, right, you have the sum story point that represent the delivery capability of the team, right? What the team to target at in this particular sprint coming up, right? So what we want to predict is that at any time in this 4 weeks, right? Anytime on this 4 weeks, right? We want to predict, right? We want to be to provide a prediction for the team, right? In the sense that, you know, if you keep doing this, right? If they keep doing what they're doing, then at the end of the sprint, they will achieve the target, right? Or they 10 points below the targets, or they 10 points above the targets. Right? So this is also about risk prediction, but this is delivery risk, okay? Delivery risk. This is useful, right? Because if the team or the team lead, right, or the Scrum, you know, team, if they know that they foresee that they are going to deliver less than what they try to target at, and they need to change, right? So that they can meet the delivery targets, okay? So what did we do? So this is also a typical, you know, machine learning classification problem, right? So we build a model like this. We extracted about 54 in our studies. We built a data set of 4,000 sprints, and it's about 60,000 issues, right, in that particular sprint. So issues here mean user stories, feature requests, a task, right? All of these are represented as the issues in the Jira tracking system. Right? And then we build a features, right, that represent a feature that represent these sprints. Right? So there are different kind of features. So the idea is that every sprint, right? Every sprint, they have a number of issues. Right? So this is like a parent-children relationship, right? And we want to represent the features of the parent by using the features of the children. Right? So the novelty of our work here is a features aggregation. The way that we aggregate the features, right? We use the features of the children, right? We aggregate them together, and we get the features to represent the sprints, which is the parents, okay? And we use different ways of features representation, okay? So here is an example that I would like. So here we have this particular sprint. So you see here is sprint number 34, and you can see at the top here, right? So this is sprint number 34. For this project, right? And these are the issues in these particular sprints, right? And every issues, they have the features, right? They have the description of the issues, they have the type of the issues, the priority of the issues, there's so many information in here, right? And then we extract these features, and then we aggregate them so that we got the features of the patterns, which is this particular script. And we use three different approaches for features aggregation, right? For feature aggregation. One is a statistical aggregation. Okay, so for example, like we count how many comments in these issues, what is the median, what are the medians, and so on and so forth, right? Of the children population. So the statistics of the children population, we use as the features to represent the patterns, which is a script, right? Or we can, another approach is that we cluster the children, right? We cluster the children in a number of clusters, and then we pick representative in each of these clusters, and that's become the features of the pattern. And then the last ones that we did is the graph, right? So in these children, they have dependencies, right? In these children of issues here, we have dependencies. So we build a graph of these dependencies between the issues in one particular sprint, and then we use the graph features like the number of nodes, number of edge, fan in, fan out, and so on and so forth. Right? So we have a different set of features that represent the sprint, which is the pattern of these children. Does it make sense, everyone? I hope.
Yeah. Okay.
So right. So and then we test it with different approach. So the study. So as I mentioned before, we did the study evaluations on about 4,000 iteration, 4,000 sprints, right? So it's about 60,000 issues on five large projects. So our approach on this here, our approach is the orange one here, right? So the lower, the better, right? This is in terms of the errors estimation as well. So the lower, the better. And this is in terms of precision and recurrence. We found that the accuracy is also consistently high on different projects. So it's around 80% accuracy. So this work was published at IEEE Transaction on Software Engineering in 2017 as well. Okay, so I give you some of the snapshot of what of our work in Agile, in AI for software project management. Right? So this is what we're doing. Okay, so what we did so far is building the tool, an AI tool, right? And that tool is quite passive in the sense that you press the button and the tool gives you some estimation, right? But now we want to build a more proactive AI, what we call agent, right? So what we want to build now, this is the work that we're doing now, is to build a co-pilot AI for Agile's agent. And this agent will be a team members. So in an Agile team, you got these that are developers, and you got this little AI co-pilot agent is part of the team. So in a planning poker session, we have this agent, right, that provide the estimation. In a risk prediction session, in the sprint planning session, we got these little agents participate in that session as well. And we want to build a more proactive, right, a more autonomous agents that become a team players. Right? So this is what we will turn the team that we did before, these passive tool, into a more proactive agent. This is what we're doing with some other people, collaborating with other people as well. So now we talk about learning. Right? So in our previous work, we use learning, we use prediction, we do estimation, right? But now what we're building in these tool is the capability of doing reasoning as well. Right? Reasoning about, for example, like planning. Right? Planning about how to commit one particular sprint. What are the tasks that they need to do, right? And then we also look into human and AI collaboration as well. So if you're interested in this line of work, I'm very keen to talk to you about this as well, right? Explore collaboration. Because this is one of the areas that we are focused on now. Okay, so that is AI for software project management, right? Which is one of the major areas of our work in AI for software engineering. We also, the second major areas that we work in this area is AI for cybersecurity, okay? So one particular problem that we try to solve here is AI for vulnerability prediction. Okay, so why do you need vulnerability prediction? Right? Just let's imagine that you work with a very large code base, right? A code base that have million lines of code, right? Very large code by million lines of code, right? And you want to do testing, right? But because, you know, let's say that they, you know, you need to do some testing on these large code base, right? But you don't have enough resource for doing this, right? Because you got a deadline that you need to release this patch tomorrow, right? So you have to do some prioritize on the, you know, which files here, which function here that you should focus on testing first, and which function or which files that you can delay the testing later, right? So this is one scenario that vulnerability prediction can help you. Okay, it can help identify or predict, right, which part of the code have a high chance of having a vulnerability, having a shopware vulnerability. So shopware vulnerability by definition is a weakness, right? It's not a bug yet, right? It's a weakness in your application that can be exploited by the attacker, right, to attacking your application. Okay. So this is a vulnerability prediction problem, right? So here is an example of a vulnerability prediction. Okay. On the slides there, you see two code listed. Right? So you see listing number one and listing number two. Okay. They look quite identical, they look very similar. But when we look at more carefully, right, we see that listing number one have a vulnerability. The problem with listing number one is that we lock the files, right? We have a lock there, right? And then we read the files. And then while we read in the files, there might be an exception, for example. And the file is corrupted or something. Right? If there is an exception, right, you catch the exception here, right? And then you close the files. And what is the problem here? The problem here is you haven't unlocked it. Right? And that will create a deadlock situation, right? And in cybersecurity, if there's a deadlock problem, there's a deadlock situation, then the attacker can exploit. Right? So this is what we call a vulnerability. Right? Vulnerability. Okay. So on the other hand, the code on listing number two doesn't have that problem, right? Because you unlock it, right? You remember to unlock it. Okay. So the idea is that we want to build a machinery that can process this listing number one, right? And it can predict that, oh, with the code in listing number one, there is a vulnerability. Right? If you see a function that has this kind of code, and it can flag us that this is a vulnerability. Okay. So you ask a question, right? So stated code analysis, they can do this kind of thing. But the problem with stated code analysis is that it gives you a loss of false positives, loss of false positives. Okay, so we want to avoid that in our approach. Okay. So this is what we want to build. This is our approach. We answer you language model, right? Again, language model. We did not call large language model back then. We called language model. Okay. We build a language model, and that language model it represents the code. Right? We build a representational learner that represents the code. Right? And then with that representation, we input it into the classifier, and the classifier will make a prediction, right? Vulnerable or not vulnerable. Okay, so it's a binary classification. Okay, so for every function, so the input here is a method of the function. Okay, so the input, the unit here is a function or a method. So this is our approach. I don't want to go into detail here. If you know one more, you can read the papers or you can talk to me during my visit. But the idea is that we answer you LSTM as well. Okay. So for every, so as I said, the method, right, the function is an input to our prediction models. So we predict if a function is vulnerable or not vulnerable, right? We predict the method is vulnerable or not vulnerable. Okay, so every method, every function, we pre-process it into a number of code token, right? You have a sequence of token here, right? Or a sequence of code token there. And then we input that into an LSTM models, right? In an LSTM models. So it will generate a set of vector, right? It will generate a vector that represents that particular function. Okay? And then we have two ways of aggregating these methods, right? A semantic pooling and a syntactic pooling. So it generates two kinds of features, right? Global features and local features. And that will help us to build the classifiers. Okay, so that is a basic, very basic idea of our work. So this is the results. So we did our evaluations on 18 Android application. Okay, and the results, we found that the local features perform better than the other features. In the paper, we also reported another evaluation. So this is evaluation on the Tizen operating system, because this project is funded by Samsung, and they want to test. They wanted us to test it on their Tizen codes. So if you know Tizen is the operating system that running like smart TV on Samsung and smart watch and so on. So then we also apply that onto those C, so the code I written in C, right? So this is the second evaluation that we reported in the paper as well. Okay, so this work has been published in IEEE DSE as well in 2018, I think. Okay, so in our previous work, we represent code as sequence, right? As sequence of tokens. Right? But if you know the code, right, you know that code is not sequence. Right? In the code, we have control flow graphs. We have program dependencies. Right? So the better way that represents the code is graph structure. Right? Is graph structure. So that's why we expanded our work. Recently, we expanded our work. This is the second part here. Okay. So now we build a model that represents the code as a graph structure. So in this graph structure, it represents the control dependencies in the code and also program dependencies as well. So there are two kinds of dependencies. So the input now is not a sequence anymore. It's a graph. Right? And we use graph neural network, right? which is a deep learning model that is suitable for graph structure inputs. And it will make the prediction, but more importantly, now it also has the capability of generating an explanation as well. And so previously, we input a function, it will predict that this function is vulnerable or not vulnerable, right? It doesn't give an explanation. But here in this work, it also generates an explanation. So an explanation in the sense of a subgraph, right? A subflow. Right, in that function that may contribute to the vulnerability, right? So we present that to the users as an explanation. Okay, so we recently published this in the IST journals. Okay, so that is AI for cybersecurity. That is also one area that we are very interested in to work on and continuing in that area as well. Another new area that we just started doing is AI for microservices, right? AI for microservices. Right? So today in the industries, lots of companies, they are moving toward this microservice architecture, right? Like Netflix, Amazon, and so on and so on. All of the big players, they're doing this kind of thing, right? They develop the application in terms of Docker, in terms of container, right? And then they, you know, block these containers together and they got the application. So that is the idea of microservices. I'm not sure if you're familiar with Docker Hub. Right? Docker Hub is a platform that you can search for these microservices. Right? So there are 10,000 of these Docker container and so on and so forth. So let's say if you want to build an online shopping application, you don't need to start everything from scratch, right? Let's say you want to build a shopping cart. What do you do? Don't code from scratch. Go to Docker Hub, right? And then, you know, do some searching for a shopping cart. It gives you a Docker, you can get that Docker and then plug it in, you know, deploy it into your application. Okay? So that is how we build software using microservice approach. Right? But when we use Docker Hub, right? In Docker Hub, they have a search function. Right? When we search for this, right? Most of the time, it did not return a useful Docker a useful microservice for us. So that is a motivation for our work, right? We want to build a better recommendation, right? What we call is a micro rec, right? And this is based on LLM as well. This is based on LLMs. So the benefit that we want to improve over Docker Hub search functionality is to improve the microservice discoveries, right? It, using Altoon, it also returns a very good, concise description of the microservice so that the developer can evaluate, right, whether this microservice, this Docker, is it compatible, does it meet their needs as well. Okay. So this is the model, this is the model architecture of our works. Okay. So when we look at the Docker Hub shows, right, we see that it returns a lot of, you know, unuseful microservices. But and then when we look at on Stack Overflow, right? So these people, they when they search for the microservices, they tend to ask the question on Stack Overflows. Let's say that you want to build a online shopping application, right? You look for a shopping cart Docker, right? So what do you do, right? You go to Stack Overflow, you create a question, you ask, you type in your question, you provide the context of your question, of your needs, right? Of the microservice that you need, right? And then people will answer you, right? So this is our corpus. We found that this is our useful corpus because, you know, when people reply with the answers, the questioner can also choose the correct answer as well, right? So we use that as a crowd tool, okay? And then we build the model here using LLMs. So we use LLM to embed the question. And we use LLM to embed the question to get a factor that represents the semantic of the question. Okay? And then for every Docker, every microservice, we also use information that is specific to the microservice as well. Okay, so this information are in the Docker file here and in the README file here. Okay, so the Docker file and the README file, it contains information that is specific to this particular microservice. So we also embed represent those description as well. Right. And then finally, we have the LLM-based encoder there to rank the microservices based on the queries. To rank it. Okay, so this is what we present to the end users. Okay. So we develop a tool here, a prototype tool here. So you can type in the query here, right? And then you can choose your LLM models, right? And then it gives you the microservice. And every microservice, it have a short description of the microservices. Okay. We compare our tool against Docker Hub search functionalities, and we found that, you know, this is the evaluation here, and we found that, you know, on about 190 queries, our tool actually recommended more accurate than the Docker Hub search functionalities. Most of the time, you can see here. Okay. So this work has recently published at the MSR's conference in 2004. Okay. And now we are moving, so my PhD student, so he's now moving, working into microservice decomposition. Okay. This is also a current problem in this area as well. So you got a classical application. Now you want to move this application, this system into a microservice architecture. What do you need to do? You need to decompose, right? Your application, your classical application, or monolithic application into these microservices. Okay, so if you're interested in this line of work, I'm happy to discuss with you as well. Okay, so in terms of software engineering and AI, we also did quite some work in privacy software engineering. Okay, so in the EC paper in 2023, we actually proposed a taxonomy of common privacy vulnerability. Okay, so if you work in cybersecurity, you know there's CVE, right? CVE, the common weakness enumeration, and so on. But when we look at it, so it's reported in this EC paper, we found that most of the entry there are focused heavily on security vulnerability. Right? But when we look at GDPR, we look at the CIDDR and so on and so forth, they talk about privacy vulnerability. but they are not captured in here. They're not covered in CVs. Mm-hmm. Right? So the paper, in the EC paper, is a call for, you know, a new enumeration that is specifically focused on privacy vulnerability, right? Because we make the case that privacy vulnerability is different from security vulnerability. Okay? That's why, you know, that is a okay. And then in the IST journals paper, we also propose a taxonomy of privacy requirements based on GDPRs. Okay? If you work in privacy, you may be, you may heard of GDPR, right? Maybe everyone heard of GDPR. But when you look at GDPR, it's a legal document. It's very abstract, very vague, right? As a software developer, you read it and you got absolutely no idea. This is for lawyers, right? This is for a lawyer to read it. So in this paper, what we do is that we want to map, right? To map all of the principles, all of the articles in GDPR into privacy requirements that are closer to software engineer. Okay, so that is the idea in this paper. Okay. We also use AI for technical debt as well. So we build AI model for identify technical debt in code, right? And more importantly, our improvement is we also propose an approach to repay the debt as well. How can we propose, how can we refactor the code, right, to, you know, remove the technical debt squares. Okay. We also have quite a lot of work in this autonomous resilient multi-agent system. So this is our work mainly with the Department of Defense in Australia on building multi-agent autonomous resilient system. Okay. So finally, this is a different type of work that that we did, right? This is not in software engineering. This is combined AI, software engineering, IoT, all together, but for a real life problem, right? For a real life problem. This is, we're talking about, you know, deploy hardware device in a very rural, in a very remote areas. Okay, so this is the project that we did an AI engineering for environmental management. Okay. So this is a particular problem in a national park. Okay. So in a national park, right, you need to monitor the different areas of the park, right? The national park is very large. So this particular national park is a wetland national park. So lots of water, you can see lots of water, okay? So lots of water. And at the moment, you know, so before our project, sorry, before our project, so the people in the national park, they, how can they keep track of different area of the park? They did it manually, right? For example, if they want to test the water, right, they need to take the sample of the water and then went back to the lab and test the water, right? And in this particular park, right, one of the things that they really want to manage is the animals, the birds in the national parks. They want to keep track of how many birds, what are different kind of birds in the national parks. And they did it manually as well. So they have some people that went through around, signed in the bus and counting the bus. All of these things in manually. Okay? So what we propose, right, what we did is we propose this new system, right, this AI IoT application. Okay? So we will have sensor. Right? You see a lot of sensors on here, a number of sensors here. You see, all of these are IoT sensors, right? IoT sensor. We have drones, right? We have drones that fly above the national park. And we have video camera. We have camera that are installed on different parts of the park, the parks, and then they collect all of these data in real time, and it's sent into the cloud. And then we have the AI application processing here. Okay, so there are two features, right? That we want to, two functionality that we want to provide to the end users. Right. One is the ability to recognize the birds, the animals, and counting them. Right. So for this particular bird, there are 12 of them. For that bird, there are 6 of them, and so on and so forth. So we want to build a model that can recognize the birds and count the birds. Right. And then the second is predicting the fire risk. So based on the information on all of the sensors, right, the air sensors, the water sensor, and so on, and based on the real time video streaming of this particular area, we want to predict the fire risk, right? There is a fire, okay? And then when there's a fire happen, right? When there's a fire happen in a national park, we want to recognize these fires and automatically send the alert to the end user as well. Okay? So this is the system that we want to build. Okay? So this is totally from software engineering. As you can see, this is AI engineering, a real thing, right? And here, these are the hardware part, right? So the example that you have here is a sensor station, is an IoT station that we develop and deploy it in the middle of the national parks. And this is a very remote areas. So no electricity, right? No internet. So we rely on the, you know, 3G, not 4G, right? And then we have to use power solar panels, right? To power the system, right? We want these power here, and so on and so forth. And here is a camera here. You can see the camera here. So this camera will keep track of, monitor the birds, the animals in these particular areas. So this is the dashboard that we presented to the end user, right? So the dashboard, you can see that it displays different indicators, right? It displays here the water. This is the water sensor, right? The water temperatures, the water turbidity, and so on and so forth, right? So this is in real time. This is what they did not have before, right? What they had before is someone had to manually go there, take the samples, went back to the lab, and then they see that. But this is, they see 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in real time, okay? And this is what they did not have before, right? Here, this is the pictures that are taken, right, from the camera that are installed, and then it do the bird recognition, right? It counting these birds. Okay, now this one, we see two of them here, this one, and so on. And it counting the birds. Okay, this is also in real time as well. Okay. And then it also can do the fire alert as well. So when there's a fire in one particular area of the park, right, the system will automatically recognize the fires and send the alerts to the end user as well. Okay. And finally, we also have this, right? This is a fire risk prediction. And this is a fire risk prediction. So it takes two inputs. One is the information about the air, the source, and then it also looks at the pictures of that particular areas. And then it combines these two inputs together and it makes the fire risk prediction. Okay. So this project, it was a fun, right? It was a break for me from software engineering into these more fun areas, but it's also helped me to realize the challenge as well. Right? I know that, you know, all of the things that I did before is in the lab environment. Right? We want perfect internet, right? We want perfect electricity. Right? We want everything is set up first. But when I work on this national park problem, I realize that everything that I have in the lab can be thrown away, right? Because we're talking about, you know, system that need to run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, right? I know that the system, the sensor, they will shut down at night because they are sourced by the power, by solar panel, right? At night, there's no sun, right? The system shut down, right? And then they have to wake up in the morning. So how can we do that? How can we set up solar, right? So there are different challenges that we need to address, you know, when we do this thing. But it was a fun experience. With that, I would like to finish my talk. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah. So for the vulnerability analysis in the code, when you employed the graph neural networks and treated code as a graph because of the dependencies, did this happen to increase the model's global awareness?
So what do you mean by global awareness? Awareness in terms of, what do you mean by global? Yeah,
so I believe you were tracking the local context and the global context, and they have different scores. And you showed that the LSTM models did really well at capturing local dependencies, but the graph, you didn't show the metrics for the graph.
I see what you mean. That is a very good question, right? In this graph-based approach that we just did, we only look at the dependency within the function. We haven't looked at the dependency across the function, right, the interdependencies across the function. But if we look at the dependency across different functions, maybe we can, you know, see the global, right, a fact that you can see there. But that is a good point for our future work. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question on similar lines about the AI Copilot for detecting vulnerabilities using CFGs. And I personally work with ASDs a lot, and I have started to work with Clang for C++ program. And I was wondering if your system architecture is applicable to different programming languages. In, for example, in the case of C and C++, it detects vulnerabilities by detecting them in the graph of the program.
Mm-hmm.
And does it have the, place for new updates on itself so that it can not only detect those vulnerabilities in the graph, but actually modify the graph using something like a tool like Clang, which is used for modifying graphs of programs all the time to rewrite code and to improve it or make it more efficient.
That is a very, very good question. So the problem that we solve here is only predicting the vulnerability. We haven't got to the part that we repair the vulnerability. I think what you suggest there is repair the vulnerability, yes. Right? Repair the suggest and the repair for the graph, right? So to fix that vulnerability, right? So there's a whole area of automated program repair. But I think, you know, even automated program repair is also only able to fix those small bugs and so on and so forth. And what we found is that in these vulnerability, there's a complex, structure that need to be modified to fix the vulnerability. But we haven't looked into that yet, to the repair part yet.
Thank you for talk. So you've exposed us to a lot of different AI projects,
mm-hmm.
And especially with the last one, you leave me with no choice but to ask, right? So each one has its own probably peculiarities, but are there some lessons that you've learned about AI engineering, LLM engineering, that could actually help many of the students in here who are pursuing similar kinds of projects? Are there some higher level things that you say, think about this?
Yes, that's a very, very good question. So the lesson, you know, some of the work that I presented was published well before LLM, right? You know, LLM, you just heard about it like 3 years ago. But as you can show, I show you over there, some of the works that we published in 2016, right? So I think the lesson that we learned is that you need to have some vision. You know, today everyone talking about LLM and so on and so forth. If you do LLM, that's fine, right? You follow the trend. But at the same time, you need to have a vision that are different from what people do it. I think that's the lesson, especially in AI. Okay? Especially in AI. At the moment, we follow LLM and so on. And I think as a universities, we don't have the capability like the big player, right, to build these very heavy LLM models and so on. Right? So billion of parameters and so on. So when we did the work in 2016, our models are 20,000 parameters already. Right? It took days for us to do the trainings. And we didn't call it LLM, we just called it a language model, right? Because it's nothing compared to millions of parameters, right? So I think in the academia, we don't have that capability to run big models, right? So that's why we need to be more creative, right? In terms of thinking about, so this is the current trend here, what else that we can do with our capability? And for the AI engineering part, I think the lesson learned is that I did all of my project before is on software engineering, right? And I work with software engineering people. I never thought that one day that I can work on this AI for engineering for national park, because it's a truly interdisciplinary project. So I led the team So in the team, we got environmental scientists, right? We got biologists, right? We got environmental team, we got IT, so it's a very large team because you need a lot of people. We have computer engineering as well to build these hardware devices because I'm not being able to do it, right? I'm a software engineer, right? So if you are a software engineer, right? If you work in software engineering, maybe sometime maybe thinking about, you know, participating in this project, right? So that you can see a big picture. You can see the impact of our work in the different areas. Okay, so that is also, you know, a lesson that I want to share. And once you work on this, you become more comfortable. I was scared at the beginning when I wrote this proposal. I was scared, right? Because I never done it before. But thanks to my team, right? Because I know that next to me, my colleague is an environmental management specialist. We got my biologist in the team. Right? So because of these expertise, we bring together and we successfully deliver this project. Right? So these projects help you to see the impact of our software engineering work as well.
Yeah. Time for one more question.
So like in the effort estimation of the story ticket, you mentioned that the story points are assigned based on the textual description. So like, does it also consider the user experience?
You mean the developer experience, is it?
Yes.
Yeah, the person that assigns to do the user story?
Yes. Like the person, who is assigned the user story,
yes,
like
yes,
they
yes.
could be the newbie as well, and they could be some experienced person
yes,
as well
yes.
with like 10 or 15 years
yes,
of
yes. So if you do storyboard estimation, so these story points, they are not absolute values. They are related values. Right? So we got two user story. This user story is 3 story points. Right? This user story is 5 story points. So 3 and 5, they are not absolute values. They are related values. So the value is to represent that this user stories, the effort of implementing this user story is less than the effort of implementing this user stories. So they are related values. And these related values tend to be independent of the developer that doing the user stories. I think that is the idea of story points. So they have these related values that represent the efforts of each, the complexity of each user story compared to each other, related to each other. Right? So that's why we only look at the user story description and the titles. Of course, right? Once you have these values, these story point values, right? If you want to translate into the actual efforts, right, the time and the budget and so on, you know, in the context of your team, your particular developer, you can also translate that as well, right? But the story point is only related values. They are not absolute values.
Okay. All right, so Hoa is going to be here for the next 2 weeks, and we have the reception right now. So let's thank Hoa and take the discussions outside to the reception.
Cameron, how are you? I saw you at Tapia, but you didn't saw me.
Remember the last time?
The Texas and the
Tour. Best food they've had.
I think that's so much time.
I heard from one of the big cameras that I was like, he doesn't feed himself.